Welcome back to Paul's Tech News, everyone, and welcome to September. You now officially have just 4 months remaining in 2024 to do all those things you told yourself you would do but haven't done. Make a checklist. It helps. I'm sure you'll get through it all. And perhaps I can assist, because the first thing on my checklist today is to give you all an efficiently curated summary of the past week's PC hardware gossip and hearsay, with an occasional sprinkling of hard facts to keep you on your toes. We have a confirmed new 7600X 3D CPU from AMD with a bit of an availability catch. Anantech has shut down, which was somehow both caused by and representative of the continued erosion of global human intelligence. NVIDIA has admitted to Blackwell yield issues, although they are still pushing for a 2024 debut, and Intel has had a difficult few weeks, to put things mildly. Each of these topics raises a slew of questions like, why does September feel like it should be fall when it's actually still mostly summer? So it's a good thing you're here for answers for tech news.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by Thermaltake's EX series fans, featuring magnetic force connectors that can daisy chain fans together to simplify installation and cable management. CT120 EX fans feature solid all-around performance and a touch of tasteful RGB lighting. The SWAFAN EX series revolutionized case fans by adding swappable fan blades, and the TUFFAN EX Pro series sports best-in-class high static pressure for use with radiators and an aggressive all-black design. And all of them feature larger magnetic force connectors for easy wiring. For more on the EX series fans from Thermaltake, click the sponsor link in the video description. If the AMD Ryzen 9000 series CPU launch last month was positively received by anyone, it was probably existing owners of the last gen 7800X3D and Linux users, but sticking to my point, 7800X3D adopters were spared any immediate FOMO or upgrade pangs thanks to chips like the 9700X showing minimal gaming performance uplift. It's all about that 3D V-cache for gaming, it would seem, so there was a noticeable undercurrent of excitement in the past few weeks as rumors spread about another new AMD CPU, the 7600X3D, a 6-core variant of the 7800X3D, which everyone assumed would cost less money. And it does exist, and it does cost less. This was all confirmed on Friday, except for one small catch, it's another Micro Center exclusive, where it will sell for $300, a few bucks more than the current going price for an 8-core 7700X, and also, notably, $30 more than the debut price of the new 9600X, which is also a 6-core. The relatively steep asking price will be offset somewhat by Micro Center's legendary combo deals, with a 3-piece kit including an ASUS TUF B650 motherboard and a 32GB DDR5 6000 memory set going for $450. But the real rub is the Micro Center exclusive status, meaning only those who can travel to one of their 28 physical US locations will have access to the 7600X3D for now. This does echo the sales plans for the Ryzen 5600X3D that also launched as a Micro Center exclusive in 2023 though, but there is some logic to the decision. Since the 7600X3Ds are all made from 7800X3D dies that were faulty and had to have cores disabled, there aren't as many of them available, which makes a global launch a little bit more difficult. So AMD is making use of those dies with a more limited offering. The 7600X3D has a huge 96MB L3 cache, of course, as well as a 65W TDP and slightly reduced clocks, peaking at 4.7 GHz turbo versus the 7600X and 7600 that hit 5.3 and 5.1 GHz respectively. The 7600X3D also won't include a cooler, and it doesn't appear that AMD was keen to sample any reviewers, so benchmark results are limited for now. But we'll probably see some trickle out as the week progresses. It's just a shame that this little 6-core isn't more widely available or less expensive. Oh, and one more bit of AMD news, that Windows update that greatly improves Ryzen CPU scheduling won't roll out until the 24H2 update, but there's now an optional update for the current version, 23H2. Just grab update KB041587, which you can get from Windows Update, Advanced Options, Optional Updates, and download more performance for your AMD CPU. AMD said the update was challenging at first until they called in an expert on backporting, so say thanks to your mom as well. Next up, we pay our respects to a newly fallen hero of the tech media world, Anantech. Editor-in-chief Ryan Smith posted this farewell tribute to the storied review website Friday morning, announcing that Anantech is shutting down for good after being given two-week notice by the website's owner, Future PLC. Founded in 1997 by the website's namesake, Anand Lal Shimpi, Anantech gained loyal readers and achieved peak status in the realm of written tech hardware reviews thanks to a focus on deep dives and technical detail down to the engineering level. The site has also featured some of the most knowledgeable and insightful writers and editors in the world who helped disseminate their knowledge so the minutiae of what makes our technology function could be more accessible to everyday readers. Anand himself left tech journalism and accepted a position at Apple back in 2014, though, and while Ryan and the team have continued to uphold his legacy since then, the tech media landscape has changed drastically in the last decade, and readership as well as content output has steadily declined. And to be fair, it is far more time-consuming and labor-intensive to write a full deep dive on a new CPU microarchitecture or an analysis of a vast array of benchmarks than it is to record a quick TikTok or short about the latest tech world drama, but it is for that very reason that many are asking if Anand Tech-style content is no longer viable, financially speaking. Attention spans and curiosity to learn about hardware with that much detail are at critically low levels. Fortunately, it doesn't seem like Anand Tech will be going away completely. Ryan said Future will be keeping the domain and the site alive as an archive for the foreseeable future, and if you would like a bit more insight on Anand Tech from someone who actually wrote for them for some time, check out Dr. Ian Cutress's video over on Tech Tech Potato, as his commentary was a bit more open and blunt in certain areas, which I appreciated. That said, rip Anand Tech, and thanks to everyone who contributed there over the years. You will be missed. Speaking of misses, NVIDIA has finally weighed in on the supposed yield misses their Blackwell AI GPUs have been experiencing. It was revealed Wednesday during their Q2 earnings call that NVIDIA has decided to make some changes to the Blackwell design to improve yields, or how many viable chips can be harvested per manufactured wafer. Per Jensen, they executed a change to the Blackwell GPU photo mask that TSMC uses to produce Blackwell GPUs on the 4NP process node. There were no changes to the underlying architecture, so while there was a delay, NVIDIA still plans to ramp up production and start shipping several billion dollars worth of Blackwell GPUs before the end of 2024. Not a bad ROI there, NVIDIA. They also reported their highest gaming revenue ever to the tune of $2.88 billion, up 8.8% over the previous quarter and 15.8% versus last year. So NVIDIA wanted to thank all of you guys for buying RTX 40 series GPUs and laptops. It says it was for back to school here, so I guess your parents took the bait. And to pat themselves on the back for their glorious success, since we've already forgotten about that stupid Blackwell delay, NVIDIA did a $50 billion stock buyback this week too. Excellent work, gentlemen. We are richer and more powerful than ever, I imagined myself saying to all the other rich NVIDIA employees before I realized that I actually don't own any NVIDIA stock and none of this benefits me personally. But I do have this 4070 Super, so it's some consolation. Speaking of AMD and NVIDIA, what about Intel? It's been a difficult few weeks for Big Blue, according to CEO Pat Gelsinger, after struggling to contain the issues with error-prone 13th and 14th gen processors and announcing 15,000 plus company-wide layoffs. Gelsinger also told investors that sales likely will be depressed for many years due to the slow development cycle of new products and the challenges inherent to building out new fabs. Critics rightfully point out, however, that Intel has had plenty of assistance this year, thanks to $8.5 billion in subsidies the US federal government provided via the CHIPS Act, and yet they are still weighing the possibility of spinning off their foundry business, as well as canceling expansion plans that they had shared previously. This would be a heavy blow to the CEO. Pat has repeatedly underscored the importance of manufacturing and how his plans to right the Intel ship are dependent on those fabs coming online. Being forced to separate the foundry side as a different business was not the plan. But hey, Pat, consider AMD. They spun off their fab business, Global Foundries, in 2009, and then they did like just really, really poorly for 8 years or so. It was pretty bad. But then they launched Ryzen in 2017 and had a huge comeback, so think about it. Speaking of thinking about things, did you know that I spend as much time crafting my tech briefs segues as I possibly can while still honoring their overall briefiness? EK Waterblocks was definitely the company who was the most happy when the Asus RMA scandal blew up back in May because it conveniently distracted from the EK not paying their employees scandal from April. But the water cooling parts maker might be in need of a September surprise if further reports of their continued struggles are to be distracted from yet again. OC3D.net posted Friday that critical employees, and we assume they mean mission critical, not, hey, why didn't I get a paycheck for the work I did critical, have departed EK recently, including lead product designer Joe Roby and head of product marketing Atla Gobor. Joe, in particular, designed many of EK's product lines, and his departure is of particular concern for EK stands. Joe will now work for Thermal Grizzly, which is CEO'd by Der Bauer, who you might have heard of. And you might also have heard of this guy, Steve from Gamers Nexus, who has indicated via a community post that another EK deep dive investigation video is imminent. I'll make the popcorn. DeepCool products, meanwhile, aren't available in the US due to sanctions related to the Russia-Ukraine war, but fellow tech YouTuber Greg Salazar recently spotted suspiciously DeepCool-ish product listings on Amazon. Were these shaking tank products actually just DeepCool products with the logos removed or covered over being shamelessly sold despite the sanctions? Well, yes and no. Yes, this shady shaking tank seller is selling stuff they're not supposed to, but it's not just a DeepCool problem. That same seller listed Cooler Master and Coolio products with blurred logos, and DeepCool isn't happy about it either. Likely gunning to preserve as much of their public image as possible in the hopes of one day returning to the US market, DeepCool said it was an unauthorized seller who obtained the products through a Chinese distributor, and that they have taken immediate action to penalize the seller and stop the sale of these debranded products. Sony would likely prefer to remove their brand name from one of the biggest video game flops ever. The Overwatch clone shooter Concord debuted on Steam late last week after 8 years of development and an estimated $50 to $200 million spent, and managed to peak at 697 total players, which is now down to more like, 150 to 175 max a week later. The title launched on PS5 and PC, but a $40 asking price and a wealth of other more polished games in the same genre, many of them free to play, made Concord unappealing to the vast majority of gamers out there. On the plus side though, the reviews are mostly positive. Finally, we close with some happy little trees and a mountain and a stunning cloudy sky, all depicted in this beautiful artwork made of Cooler Master Cryofuse 5 Prism Thermal Paste. Sure, colored thermal paste serves no real purpose, but what is art if not the embodiment of our aesthetic delights in contrast to that which is practical or functional? How does one even install a CPU cooler on top of this, though, is my question. It's like cutting into a cake after it's decorated. Hopefully this becomes a standard part of the PC building process. Sure, his build had great cable management, but the heat spreader painting was more of a Matisse, and I was hoping for Renoir. And it's not often I get to end on a fine art joke, but there you have it, guys, tech news for the week. And if you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all of the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested. And you can also check out my store at paulshardware.net for high quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.